Hey guys, welcome to another video. So in this video, I'll go over a paper about deep autoencoders. So it's LLNet, a deep autoencoder approach to natural low-light image enhancement. So they're using autoencoders to enhance low-light images and also noisy images. The reason I chose this paper is because not only will we learn what autoencoders are, but we'll also go over some fundamental concepts in computer vision. So hopefully that will really help you when you read future papers. Important thing to remember is that deep learning is a technology that we are applying to the domain of computer vision. So it's really important to understand some fundamental basics in that domain so that we can better understand what our model is doing, how we can make it better, and generally how researchers approach problems. So let's dive in. So some of the important cases of this use cases of this paper are security applications. So many security cameras are very old and they aren't the most high tech, and changing them is very expensive. So we can enhance these type of noisy images. Also for military missions where the devices are extremely small, so we can't have a very high resolution camera. So often they're very drastically impacted by noise and light. Satellite images and you know, medical hardware, like really old medical hardware that's really costly to upgrade. So this is what an autoencoder looks like. We input a bad image and we have it spit out a much cleaner version of that image. And as you can see, the middle layer over here is much smaller than our input layer. So if our input had 700 features, this layer over here is going to force our network to represent all that information in just maybe 100 features. So essentially, we are just learning the important parts of the image. So we don't want to learn all this noise. We just want to learn, you know, the essential structure that makes up the image and just what we need to deconstruct a cleaner version. And so our network will learn to identify these important features based on the training examples that we show it. So if we show it a much cleaner version of this and have it train on that, it will learn that this type of statistical pattern that overlays an image is not essential, doesn't really capture the, you know, the information required to deconstruct a cleaner version. So it will remove that. So we pass in an image and the encoder, which is the first half, compresses the image and forms a very dense representation of the important features, and the second part, which is the decoder, then scales it up to reconstruct the image. So in this case, our input would be a very noisy image and our output would be a fixed version of that image, and this is really the original image. So we would train our model on the noisy version and the original version and have it reconstruct something that looks like the original. So autoencoders have applications in a wide variety of use cases. So in high resolution, in removing kind of distortions that come under certain circumstances, in image coloring, going from black and white to color, and also in painting. So if you have text or any kind of object blocking certain parts of an image, you can make the network kind of reconstruct what would be in their place. So before we move further, let's try to understand some basic concepts of computer vision. So a pixel, so an image is represented in terms of pixels, and a pixel just conveys the intensity. So if the intensity is really high, it's white, and if it's really low, it's black. And they're represented on the scale of 0 to 255. So in this image, you can see that the black parts are really low and the white parts are really high. And so usually this is just represented as a matrix. So any image can be broken down into three channels, and each of these channels has an intensity matrix just like this, upon which we then apply the color filter. So for example, this image in its broken down channels, we see that the area where there's green, here the pixels are really white, while these two are pretty black, so we get green. Similarly for the red region, this is pretty white, while these two are very black, so red really dominates. So in low light images, a lot of the pixel intensities are shifted to one side of the spectrum, and they're also really close to each other, so it's really hard for us to distinguish between the features. So in this example, we see if we plot a histogram of the pixel intensities, that they lie on a really small bandwidth, and most of them are really here. So it's really hard for our eyes to really distinguish between small differences in the image. Whereas if we take the same histogram and spread the intensities across the entire pixel intensity range, we see that a lot of the features that we couldn't see before become apparent. So this is a technique called histogram equalization, and it's the most famous technique in computer vision to enhance bad quality images. So it's basically just spreading out the pixel intensities over the entire range. And this is the primary method to which we'll be comparing our model to. So can you guess what the output of this would look like? As you can see, the results are quite mind-blowing. A lot of the features that just weren't apparent at all in this image suddenly become apparent now. So, you know, the eyes, the mouth, all of this stuff, you couldn't really see it in this image. But actually, this image encodes all that information. It's just that the pixel intensities are so close to each other that our eyes can't really perceive these features. So you can see why this is such a popular technique. And also we can apply this to colored images. So we apply it on each channel separately. But histogram equalization has some drawbacks. So for example, in this image is slightly noisy, and histogram equalization has enhanced all that noise because it doesn't really recognize the noise as noise. It just enhances everything. Similarly, in this image, you can see that, you know, a lot of the small differences have been enhanced too much. That doesn't really make the image look too good, and it kind of takes away from the main focus of the image. So as you can see in this image, the face has become a bit too bright. This is called oversaturation, and it doesn't make the images look too natural. Also, this technique doesn't take into account higher level features. So it just converts every pixel to this intensity range and just spreads it across no matter what they are. So it isn't really understanding what the pixels are representing. It isn't taking into account the overall structure of the image or the particular context that the pixels are forming. So let's get to the paper. So in the abstract, he says that he proposes a deep autoencoder based approach to identify features from low light images, and he tries to brighten the images without over amplifying or saturating them. And so he also presents another variation to autoencoders, which are stacked sparse denoising autoencoders, and we'll go over that later. One really important key point in this paper is that he synthetically darkens and adds noise to his training examples. So he takes images from the internet and adds noise and corrupts them himself. So this drastically reduces the amount of money and time that he has to spend collecting data, and virtually makes his data set unlimited. So the introduction just states some important use cases of this method. He calls his architecture LLNet or low-light net, and this method takes advantage of local path-wise contrast improvement. So we're taking into account the structure that the pixels are forming or what other pixels are doing around the pixel, and accordingly denoising or improving the contrast based on that. And so his contributions are, he presents a stacked denoising autoencoder, which is basically two autoencoders, one after each other. And he also synthetically modifies these images from the internet. And so this procedure is repeated on natural low-light images to demonstrate the enhanced capability of synthetically trained models. So he's saying that this method of synthetically enhancing and cleansing them can then be applied to natural images, and it does pretty well. So he goes over some historical works that have been used for a long time. So histogram equalization is really the main work, which the other works are very strongly dependent on. And we've gone over that. And so his particular network takes inspiration from something called a SSDA, or stacked sparse denoising autoencoder. And what this is basically, he introduces two models. One of them is like the autoencoder we saw earlier. So there's just one of them, and it has to simultaneously improve the contrast and denoise the image, while his second model splits this task into two parts. So the first autoencoder just improves the contrast, while the second one just denoises the image. And stacked basically means, so I showed you earlier that the layers subsequently get smaller. Well, in this one, the layer actually gets bigger. And so this layer can learn many, many small features from this image. And then this representation is compressed. Similarly, as this is a compressed representation, we want to best extract the features that we can. So we expand this so that we can really capture all the minute patterns, and then we reconstruct the image. So all of these are the same size. So these three layers are the same size as the input, and this architecture has been proven to do really well in this type of reconstruction task. So the key aspect of our network is that it's trained on images obtained from the internet. So he makes a really important big point out of synthetically processing these images. And so let's see how he does that. And so he uses something called gamma transformation. And this is an incredibly simple procedure. So you just express the pixel intensities from 0 to 1. So you divide everything by 255. And then you just raise every pixel value to the gamma factor. So if your pixel value was 0.5 initially, if you raise it to 2, you get 0.25. So it's become much darker. And you know, we can raise it to a number less than 1 also, but then you get a brighter image, as you can see. So for the purposes of this training, we just keep gamma always greater than 1, as you want to always darken them. And so this is a very simple implementation of that in TensorFlow. So noise can be added by just creating a Gaussian array of normally distributed numbers and then adding it to our input image. And we can adjust our gamma by an inbuilt TensorFlow function and making the gamma factor random. And so by using functions almost identical to these, he synthetically adds noise to the images. So as you see, what he does is that he takes an image and then he adds a gamma adjustment to it, and then he adds a noise function to that image. So now let's see how he trains these models. So first let's consider the LLNet, which is this one. So the LLNet takes in an input dimension of 17 by 17 pixels, which is 289 units. So most modern images are much larger. They are about 2000 into 2000. So we'll see how he applies this model to those larger images later. And his first layer, his first denoising layer is 867 units, the second one is 578, and the smallest layer, which is called the bottleneck layer, is 289. And then for the decoder, it's 578, 867. So these two layers are the same size, and so are these two layers. So it's been shown that this kind of symmetry in our autoencoder can improve performance slightly. And so he does something very interesting. So he pre-trains the model for 30 epochs, which is he takes the entire training set. So if it's 10,000 images, he trains it 30 times over the 10,000 images, and he sets the learning rate as 0.1 for the first two layers and 0.1 for the last layer. So he sets these two as 0.1 and this as 0.01. So basically what he's making his network do is that these two layers will make much faster improvements. So they'll be generally, after you know, a few thousand runs, they'll be much more accurate than this one. So because this can't keep up, these two layers will be forced to better model the representations and kind of make up for the inefficiency of this layer. And then after he's done that for 30 epochs, he sets all of the learning rates to 0.1, and then he trains it for another 200 epochs. So once this has learned really important features, then he kind of unfreezes everything and he allows this to better take the important features that these have learned. And after he does that for 200 epochs, he decreases the learning rate for all to 0.1. And he keeps on training it until he gets a 0.5% improvement from where he left off over here. So all of these specific numbers are got after a lot of trial and experiment. You know, these researchers have access to large amounts of computational power. So they just kind of tinker and see what works best. But pre-training generally has shown to give really enhanced results in case of autoencoders. As you can see by this graph, which is especially for autoencoders, that pre-training can lead to significant performance improvements. And so, moving on to the SLNet, which is the stacked LLNet. So what he does over here for pre-training is that he first completely shuts off the denoising module. So he freezes all the layers over here. So he takes an image and he only distorts the contrast. Then he passes in the distorted contrast image and he trains it on the clean image. And he does this for how many ever epochs. Then he shuts off this, or he freezes this, and then he adds noise to some image and he passes in the noisy image through here, and the clean version is here, and this module just is trained on denoising the image. And then finally, after he's trained these two modules separately, he unfreezes all the layers and then he passes in images where noise has been added, the contrast has been changed, or both, and he lets both of them train together. So now they're training in harmony, and anything that one mistakes, the other one can fix. So because normally when you pass in an image, the contrast will be changed, and then the output of the contrast module will go into the denoising module. So the denoising module isn't seeing the original input. So it's important that the contrast module gives the denoising module a good enough information to then work its features on. So fine-tuning the model is pretty important. So now let's look at how he handles images which are much larger. So if you go to the presentation, and so this is our general pipeline. We take in a regular image, we add some noise to it, and we pass that noisy image through our autoencoder, and we get a reconstructed output. So what he does for much larger images is that he breaks up the image into 17 by 17 patches with a stride of 3. He then passes each patch inside the autoencoder to obtain a corresponding enhanced patch, and then he stitches all those patches together, and wherever they overlap, he averages the value. So for example, suppose we have this image. So first he breaks a patch of 17 by 17 and he just passes this patch into the autoencoder. He gets a cleaner patch and he places it back here. Then he takes a step of 3. Then he takes another patch of 17, he passes it through the autoencoder, he gets a clean patch and he places it here. Now there are regions where our first and our second patch overlap. So he simply averages out those pixel values. Then he takes another step of 3, takes another patch, passes it, puts it back, averages the value, and he does this for the entire image. And he does that for all the 3 channels. And so he mentions that over here in image reconstruction. And he says that he tried different patch sizes, but this one worked the best. So the way he trains his model is that he takes an image and he produces about 2500 patches from that, from random locations, and he applies different darkening and noising parameters, and he adds them non-linearly. So you know, generic computer vision models that don't use deep learning, they can only add an enhancement linearly throughout, the same enhancement throughout the entire model. So they'll just apply the same gamma factor to improve the image, and that'll be same throughout all the pixels of the image, while a convolution network can apply different gamma factors to different areas of the image. So this is a very powerful feature of our network. And here he just mentioned some metrics. So he says that the gamma factor is chosen randomly between 2 and 5. And his noise function looks something like this. And so he has two different loss functions when he's pre-training his model and he's fine-tuning his model. And in the pre-trained version, he basically uses something called the KL divergence, which I'll make a separate video for later, but it's really simple. It's just finding the expected difference in the probability distribution between any two things. So in this case, it's images. And otherwise, his loss function just has the regular mean square error and a regularizer. And that's basically the training procedure of his entire model. Now let's move on to performance metrics. So don't we all love MSE? MSE is by far the most used performance metric, but it doesn't really translate very well to images. So this is an original image, and all of these are distorted versions that I have almost, these four have the same MSE, and they look drastically different to our eyes. So MSE doesn't really translate very well to visual assessment. As you can see over here, all the pixel intensities have been reduced in one direction. Over here, they've been increased in one direction. Over here, half of them have been left unchanged, while the other half have been changed a lot. And over here, values at the edges have been brought closer together, so they look blurred. So MSE doesn't really capture everything that would be quantified as good to our visual system. So let's come up with another performance metric. So suppose we had a mean square error of 1, but the error that we could make was 100. So that's pretty good. But suppose we got an error of 1 and the maximum error that we could make was 5. So in that case, 1 would be really bad. So we want to quantify this. We want to quantify the error that we made relative to the maximum error that we could make. So these are some shortcomings of MSE. And you can read these. So you want to link our performance to the ratio of the maximum possible error we could have possibly made by the error we did make. So this would be represented as the max value that our intensity can take on minus the min value, and we already know the error we made. That's the MSE, and since the MSE is squared, we're going to square this value also. And because in regular images, you know, 255 minus 0, the whole squared, can be a very large number, we want to make the number more readable to our eyes. So we add a log over here. And this is exactly what the PSNR value is, the peak signal to noise ratio. And this is just a scaling factor to make the number more interpretable to us. So we take the max value, which is usually 255 or 1. And we subtract it from the min value, which is 0 usually, and we divide it by the MSE and we take the log of that. And another very useful and important performance measurement metric is the SSIM, or the structural similarity index. And this basically calculates the interdependency of pixels, and it takes into account the general structure of the image. So over here, the structure hasn't been changed a lot. But over here, the structure has been changed hugely, right? So the MSE remains the same, but the SSIM decreases drastically. And so, you know, for MSE, I can really, instead of adding a very small distortion to the entire image, I can just pick a small part and very greatly distort it. So humans may not be able to perceive a small change throughout an image, but they will perceive a very dense change. So MSE is not very good in capturing the structural nature of images that we generally look for. So that's basically the final paper. Then it's just the concluding remarks and some possible improvements that can be made. And yeah, so we see that this model works much better than traditional models. And I suggest you make some autoencoders yourself. They're incredibly powerful. There are even generative autoencoders that, instead of reconstructing the same image, they construct different types of images from just one image, or they change it to different styles. So thank you for watching, and I would appreciate your feedback, likes and comments. Thank you.